cathedral hill at Downpatrick is one of Ireland's most sacred sites and has a rich history stretching back as far as the 5th century, when it's thought St. Patrick founded the first church here. But how much of that important history still survives under the ground? In last Sunday's programme, Time Team were offered the rare opportunity to find out.
I'm Robin Bush, and welcome again to Time Team Extra, the programme which, I'm delighted to say, gives us a chance to look in more depth at the background history associated with last Sunday's Time Team programme. Joining me today is Dr. Peter Harbison of the Royal Irish Academy, who of course was with us on that dig. He's an expert on the early church in Ireland. I thought we'd start this week's programme with something you didn't get to see on Sunday. And this is it. The letter of permission from the bishop, without which we couldn't even put a spade in the ground. This is the faculty, as they call it. And it's a beautiful thing, isn't it? Complete with the bishop's signature and seal. So, we had our permission to dig on the cathedral hill at Downpatrick, but I think everybody realised what a challenge we had on our hands.
Presumably this church is pretty modern.
Well, most of what you see is an 18th century rebuild of the medieval abbey that was here, that was founded in the 12th century, and some of the buildings actually 13th century. But that actually might be a clue, you see, Tony, because you can see the rather strange site where it's on the flat there, and then it sort of drops
slopes
down
away.
This end.
You can see this line here,
yeah, the stream,
which is
course.
Sort of parallel with the ground here, and then the line carries on there, but the ground just slopes away.
I mean, you wouldn't build like that because you'd go for the top of the hill. You wouldn't project out like this unless there was some reason why you couldn't build on the top. You know, perhaps there was some earlier structure there that you were trying to avoid when you built this church.
Which might have something to do with St. Patrick.
Yeah, who, I mean, St. Patrick's 5th century, this is 12th onwards, so there's a long period of the early Christian period when this might have been respecting something that was plonked on top of the hill.
Mick's idea that we might find evidence of early structures behind the present-day cathedral
this
was supported by Peter Harbison, who had recently found a plan
hill.
Showing the location of an early Christian round tower.
What have you got there?
Yeah, this is a plan of 1799, which I came across last year. And if you take that as being the corner of the cathedral, the corner is repeated here. And on the basis of that, we can locate a round tower, which was taken down in 1790. And what we're trying to do here is we're mapping out the exact location of the round tower, hoping to go and find it.
And what sort of date is it?
Probably about 10th, 11th century or thereabouts.
So it isn't anything to do with St. Patrick?
No, but they are an indicator of an early site because they tend to be in the middle of the centre of the complex where the church... Come and have a look at what Victor's drawing. You'll see the sort of context of them. So we're up on the top of the hill and we've got our high crosses and our churches, and there's the bell tower in the middle of the early complex of buildings there.
The bell tower was still standing until the 1790s and was drawn by several artists.
Peter, these round towers are very curious structures. What do we gather they were used for?
Well, the old Irish word for these towers was clinchoch, which means literally a bell house or a bell tower. They're not like the bell towers that we have in churches today. They were towers where someone would have gone up right to the top, 100 feet high, with a handbell like this. And with this handbell, they would have told the people out in the fields to come in to prayer.
I understand that the earliest reference that we've got to a bell tower is in 948, when one at Slain, which I think is about 30 miles from Downpatrick, one was burnt by the marauding Vikings. And I've got a description of this happening. The bell tower was burned, they say, by foreigners, with its full of relics and distinguished persons, together with the lector of Slain and the crozier of the patron saint and a bell, the best of all bells. I love that, best of all bells. But that extract would suggest that these towers were being used not only for ringing bells, but also for refuge at times of trouble.
Yeah, well, one of the characteristics of almost all of the Irish round towers is the fact that the doorway was placed about 10 to 14 feet above ground level. Mm-hmm. And it has for long been presumed, rightly or wrongly, that the reason for that is that the round towers were built as a refuge, if you like, as a defence, and that there would have been a little ladder going up to the doorway, which you would have rushed up in times when the Vikings came along. You would have pulled the ladder after you closed the door and gone up to the top and poured boiling oil down them or whatever. And the fact that the Downpatrick one is at ground level, one of only two in the whole country which has the doorway at ground level, would suggest that it was built certainly long after the Viking troubles had passed.
Mm-hmm. Sadly, the round tower at Downpatrick proved strangely elusive.
Outside the cathedral, we've now checked the other end of Trench 1 and can find no sign of the early Christian bell tower.
We do know that the foundations of round towers were very often not very deep. They were sometimes only about, 3 feet deep.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so It may be that in doing various works here, when the cathedral was being restored between 1790 and 1818, it just took the whole lot away.
But it takes a real man to know when to stop looking, doesn't
it? That's right, yes. No, I think, with reluctance, I say, yes, I think we'll give it up. I still feel that my original plan was correct.
It didn't stop us showing how the round tower might have looked standing next to the later church built here.
Forenza to Stuart, over.
By day two, we realised that later building work on top of the hill had destroyed most of the archaeology, and we turned our attention to the slopes of the hill.
There's some terrific earthworks here, Carranza. There's a strong bank and a ditch outside it. There's a sort of nice dip on it, and it looks as if it's been filled in.
The only way to find out if the ditch had belonged to the early Christian monastery, rather than anything later, was to dig it and hope for dating evidence.
So what do we think this ditch would have been for?
Well, the obvious thing to think is that it's defence, because it's around the top of the hill. It's much more likely that it's actually meant to be a sort of boundary, not a defence, but something that says outside this is the ordinary secular world, the everyday world, and inside this is something special.
We found our dating evidence.
Stuart, what we have here is a piece of pottery, souterrain ware. You can see it's got a basal angle on it just there, so we're dealing with the corner of the pot. And this is coil built, it's not wheel thrown. You can just see the sort of curvature of the coils.
So that's diagnostically early Christian pottery.
Very much so,
exactly,
yeah.
The sort of thing we've been looking for.
Our luck had changed, and by day three, one early Christian ditch had turned out to be two early Christian ditches, and geophysics had great success finding more evidence of them circling the hill.
So we've now got the ditch running from the line in the north all the way around to Nick's trench
That's
in the
wonderful.
South, and then the outer ditch, some 15, 20 metres away in parts, coming up here.
By locating the ditches, we were able to get an idea of the extent of the site and create a picture of how the early Christian monastery might have looked in the 10th century.
What you found, in fact, was the outermost boundary of the monastery. And these monasteries can have had anything up to two or three boundaries. And the innermost one, which was bounded by a stone wall usually, it was the area of sanctuary, where anyone who was being pursued by an enemy could find sanctuary and could not be disturbed, according to old Irish law. And it's very interesting to see an early Irish monastery at a place like Nendrum, which is only a couple of miles from Downpatrick, and it, in fact, is the most extensively excavated monastery that we have, and it gives us probably the best visual idea as to what one of these early Irish monasteries looked like. In the centre, you have the church, and there was the round tower next door to it, and this was all enclosed within one wall. And between the first wall and the second wall, we presume that there would have been the houses of the monks, where they would have carried out their various different chores, preparing the vegetables for the food, or in fact writing manuscripts, or possibly even carving high crosses. And then there was a third wall outside that again, there that they probably would have had their vegetable patch, and possibly also would have kept their cattle as well.
Peter, I don't know whether you saw this, but when we were digging out the ditches at Downpatrick, we came across this early medieval arrowhead, which is a good indication of what happened next in the history of this hill.
Oh, this is a fascinating find, I must say. This is an armour-piercing arrowhead, probably late 12th, 13th century.
Which is not what you'd expect to find in a monastery.
Certainly not, no, but it shows you people who are coming in much better armed than the Irish themselves were, coming in and taking over the place. And these were Normans who were coming in from England, very well armoured, and using armour-piercing arrowheads. So this can surely only have been the Normans.
I'm going to cut you off there, Peter, and believe you me, that's not easy. Join us in part two to discover what happened to the early Christian monastery when the Normans arrived from England. And also follow me to Ireland as I return to discover what life was like there for the average monk. Welcome back. With me this week is Peter Harbison, who's an expert on the early Christian church in Ireland. Peter, we were talking about the early Christian monastery at Downpatrick, and you were about to tell us what happened when the Normans invaded Ireland from England.
Yes, well, the Normans, in 1177, on February the 1st... we know that a man called John de Courcy, who was a Norman baron, he marched up from Dublin in 4 days, and he attacked Dún do Lechlóis, which is the old Irish name for Downpatrick. And in fact, there's a wonderful quote, which, if I may, I'll read for you here. It says, "The valiant knight John de Courcy came secretly with a band of knights and archers from Dublin to Dún do Lechlóis, and reaching it unperceived, they made a dike from sea to sea about Dún, the Ulidh," and I should say that the Ulidh are the local indigenous population, "the Ulidh then assembled to make an attack on Dún against John, but on reaching it, they retreated without striking a blow when they saw the Englishmen with their horses in full battle dress. When the Englishmen saw the Ulidh in flight, they followed them with their people and inflicted slaughter upon them both by drowning and by the sword."
Sounds rather like the Spanish attacking the Aztecs or the Incas.
Yes, yeah, kind of reaction. It was obviously pretty violent anyway.
The Englishmen mentioned in that text were of course the Normans invading from England. And this is where the Norman baron, John de Courcy, is thought to have made his base, just next to the Cathedral Hill. And records show that by 1185, he had replaced the early Christian monastery with a much grander, continental-styled Benedictine monastery.
Have we got any idea, Peter, why John de Courcy would have wanted to found a monastery here?
Well, in medieval times, people wanted to found monasteries because they thought that this was a better way of getting to heaven, that if they had the monks saying prayers for them, that they would have a much better chance of getting a higher place in heaven. But as well as that, I think he probably would have wanted to go and take control of the local church and to really, put into the background the old Irish church, which had been there in Downpatrick before he arrived.
The Benedictine monastery, of course, would have been on a much grander scale. And to our delight, we found evidence of it still surviving in the ground.
We've got more of the slate roofs, so we know what the roof looked like. And what do you think of this, then? Look at that dressed ashlar block.
Yeah. That's presumably something to do with the medieval buildings of the abbey.
Undoubtedly, yeah. Mm. But look at this, too. Mm. I can show you this bit out of the bag.
Lead.
Oh. Ah, look. You see, it's two bits squashed together. So, in fact, it has had the gap for the glass to go down. Right. That's very good, isn't it?
Look at this. Look what else we got. Now, that I'm not going to take out of the bag.
Ah, yes.
But that is the window glass.
Right.
I mean, so all those colours aren't painted?
No, that's all part of the decay, the laminations. But, I mean, the main thing is it's a very, very high status building.
Yeah.
Isn't it? I mean, there's no monkeying about with that.
Yeah.
So this trench has done its job. And we can now picture this high status building, which we think was probably a guest house situated alongside one of the roads leading into the Benedictine monastery.
Some bits of the medieval Benedictine abbey were easier to recognise than others.
I mean, I've been to hundreds of monastic sites, and the only thing I can think of is it looks like the bottom of the latrines or the guardrobe shafts coming down from above and then going off a slope like that. But it doesn't feel a very satisfactory explanation, really.
However, by the time the bishop turned up to take a look at the end of our final day, Phil had developed a theory about what it could be.
What we've actually got are two rubbish chutes that are emptying from a kitchen into these two vast pits, and they're full up with an amazing array of bone. Animal bones, we've got fish bones, we've got bird bones. So they're obviously living on an incredibly rich diet. I mean, they weren't starving, believe me.
And that fits with a historical reference I found in 1617 to a hall and a kitchen in the cloister on the north side of the church.
Yeah?
Perfect.
Steve's 3D computer graphic gives us one interpretation of how this building could have looked, complete with working rubbish chutes.
One find which didn't appear in the programme is this, a piece of pottery which turned up in a trench near the rubbish chutes. I don't know what you think it is, Peter.
Ah, this is the spout of a pottery jug called an aqua manile, and it represents the head of an animal, I think probably a horse, and you would have had the body of the animal out here. This would have had a handle on it, and in order to pour your wine, you would have tilted the aqua manile up like that, and the wine would have come out of the spout.
I think that has to be probably the most delightful find that we turned up over
our
weekend.
I would agree. I think this is a beautiful piece. To me, this is the most fascinating find to have come from the whole Time Team dig.
Victor's illustration of me as a medieval Benedictine monk, alongside Mick as a slightly tatty early Christian variant, was inevitably one of the highlights of last week's Time Team programme, for me at any rate. And it started me thinking, what was life really like for a monk in medieval Ireland? So, I went back to Ireland to find out.
There were close to 500 monasteries in Ireland in the medieval period, but thanks to the dissolution of monasteries in the 16th century, few of them survive as anything more than ruins today. This is Mellifont Abbey, about 30 miles from Dublin. It was founded by Cistercian monks in 1142, but would have been built to the same plan as the Benedictine monastery at Downpatrick.
This is all that's left of the great abbey church. Here I would have stood shoulder to shoulder with my fellow monks underneath a soaring crossing tower and a great vaulted roof, praying and singing the plain chant. And this gives you a wonderful idea of the incredible extent of this church, which from its sanctuary at the far end stretched a full 190 feet.
The abbey church was attached to a rectangular cloister, which led to the other main buildings of the monastery. The monk's dormitory on the left, accommodation for lay brothers on the right, and the more domestic buildings like the refectory, the kitchens, and the infirmary towards the back. Close to the abbey church was the second most important building of the monastery, the chapter house. So called because the monks' daily meeting there started with a chapter being read from the rule of Saint Benedict.
This is the chapter house. I can easily imagine myself as one of the monks sitting on a hard wooden bench here. The abbot would have presided over meetings of the monks to discuss all the important business of the abbey.
These ruins are fine for giving a sense of scale. But I wanted to know more about the monks themselves, so I arranged to meet up with Father Abbot Christopher Dillon, a modern-day Benedictine monk.
So, I'm a Benedictine monk. When would my day have started? How would it have been laid out for me?
Well, if you're an observant monk and not in the infirmary, you would have been up at 2:30 in the morning to sing vigils, and that would have gone on for the best part of 2 hours before you got out. And then you would spend time reading, muttering the psalms. You then had a series of 6 more offices in the course of the day, punctuated by the 2 major offices, Lords in the morning and Vespers in the evening, and that could add up to about 6 or 7 hours.
As a medieval monk, I would have eaten a meal of vegetables and bread twice a day. I wouldn't have been allowed any meat unless I was ill, and in Lent, I would have only had 1 meal a day. It was a tough life. Why did people want to become monks?
I'd say that's a very difficult question. You're talking really about what drives someone to be converted to this or that. Leading up to the year 1000, we have a situation which is very interestingly comparable to today. Millenarianism. Mm-hmm. Is Christ going to come again on
the
clouds?
Yes.
And you have the most extraordinary explosion leading up to the year 1000. Literally thousands of men and women hurtling off to monasteries to be, I suppose, on the right side of whatever the incredible divide might be.
Impelled by fear to celebrate the millennium.
Well, just to be sure that you were celebrating it in the right way when it happened, yes.
Sure.
And I think there's maybe there's something the same thing happening today, because certainly we have a very gratifying number of men of every age wanting to take the habit, as it were. And for as many different reasons, really, as there are individuals.
Sure. Peter, someone we haven't really talked about is St. Patrick. I suppose, really, because the archaeology that we turned up didn't go quite back as far as the 5th century when he's supposed to have been there. But he is believed to have been buried there, wasn't he?
Yeah, well, there is a tradition going back as far as the Book of Armagh, which is early 9th century, to say that he was buried in Downpatrick. Now, it's considered that he died in a place called Saul, which is only a couple of miles away from Downpatrick. And we just simply don't know where St. Patrick is buried.
Isn't it a point worth making that if Armagh Cathedral, the major ecclesiastical site in the area, could have done, they would have claimed Patrick's burial place for themselves?
Yes, well, certainly Armagh would dearly have loved to have had the relics of St. Patrick, but they didn't. And I would agree with you that that makes the Downpatrick claim all the stronger. The answer is we just don't know. But Patrick is nevertheless a person who is associated with Downpatrick, but not from his own time, it should be said. The first time, it's only in about the 12th century that the name Patrick begins to be associated with Downpatrick itself.
We've talked John de Courcy claimed to have discovered not only St. Patrick's body, but Columbkill and St. Bridget as well.
That's right, and you can take this with as many grains of salt as you wish. I would regard this as, at the time, a terrific publicity coup for John de Courcy to have suddenly got all the three national saints to have discovered them in Downpatrick, all lying beside one another. I mean, we know St. Columba was buried in Iona. How he exactly got from Iona to Downpatrick, I don't quite know.
And yet, still in the grounds of Downpatrick Cathedral, there is this stone that is set, supposedly marking the grave of St. Patrick, put there, I gather, in 1900.
That's right, yeah. By the local antiquary, a man called Brigger, who just put it there. But, I mean, there's no tradition that that, in fact, was where St. Patrick's grave actually was.
Well, that's about it for this week, except for one clip that didn't manage to creep into the programme last Sunday, courtesy of the director. The one where I do manage to hit the right notes in the medieval plain chant. But before we show that, there's time to say thank you, Peter, for joining me. To add, don't forget to watch Time Team next Sunday and to join me for a little Time Team extra next week. Cheerio for now.
Preclaram sanctis largitos ens gratiam.
Salvat